My name is Chris Quinn. I'm the youth pastor here at Portland Community Church. We've been going through a series called Last Words. These are the last words that the Apostle Peter wrote. So we call this book 2 Peter. And a lot of what Peter does is he kind of ties things back to some things that Jesus had said about his coming return and even warnings about false teachers. And specifically, Jesus says this about false teachers in Matthew 7:15 in the middle of his very famous, what we call Sermon on the Mount. He said, "Watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious wolves." This is quite the vivid picture, and you actually should see it on the screen, that you could see that there are these people that might look like Christians, and we talked about this last week, that might look like they're Christians, but on the inside, they are something completely different, and that their motive is actually to distract, deceive, and distort what Jesus has already taught, and to pull people away from the true gospel in Christ. And yet, there are still wolves in sheep's clothing throughout our day. They are still around trying to distract people away from what the truth of the gospel is, and they might look like they're Christians. They might have the veneer and appearance of it and even say that they are, but their teaching is such a massive departure from the faith that it is absolutely not true that they come from Christ. And so how do we identify these false teachers? How do we know who they are and what they're doing? First of all, Jesus said right after that statement about the ferocious wolves, he says, "By their fruit you will recognize them." He says a good tree produces good fruit, but a bad tree produces bad fruit. So what is this fruit he's talking about? These are things that result from a person's spiritual life. And to go into more specifics, you go to Galatians chapter 5, where Paul talks about, yes, the fruits of the Spirit, which are very famous, but he also before that talks about the fruit of the flesh, which are things like sexual sin, greed, okay, exploiting other people. These are kinds of things that result from the flesh, that when you live after the world and pursue the pleasures of the world, that's what results from your life. But if you pursue Christ and become like him, that will what will result in the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control. And so that when we are trying to identify who is and who is not a false teacher, what we do is we look at their character and the things that they teach and what results from their teaching. What are the results that come out of it? So last week we talked about where a false teacher's power comes from, but this and also the coming judgment that's coming because of the fact that they have taught things that are deceiving people. And that this week, Peter is going to lay before us the false teachers, like why they deserved the judgment that was coming upon them, and details their very specific behavior. So this is going to come across very harsh and very angry, but Peter is doing this because he wants people to not be distracted and deceived, but wants them to follow the truth and come to a saving relationship with Jesus Christ. So we got to deal with the wolves. And so that's what he does here. So today, we're going to look at four defining characteristics so that we can identify false teachers for ourselves. And so here's our summary statement for this morning, that false teachers seek to take the place of God, deceive and manipulate the spiritually immature, legitimize sinfulness, and reject or distort the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so let me give you just a quick reminder of the background. Peter wrote to this collection of churches in Asia Minor, and he is trying to restore order back into the church because these false teachers had come in and brought disorder and were teaching that Jesus was never going to return and that they could live however they wanted because there was no coming judgment upon them. And Peter wants to correct that again so that people are not deceived and pulled away from the true gospel. So let's go ahead and begin. We'll begin in verse 10b through 12. "Bold and arrogant, they are not afraid to heap abuse on celestial beings. Yet even angels, although they are stronger and more powerful, do not heap abuse on such beings when bringing judgment on them from the Lord. But these people blaspheme in matters they do not understand. They are like unreasoning animals, creatures of instinct, born only to be caught and destroyed. And like animals, they too will perish." You can actually take the first couple words that he says in this statement. You could say they were boldly arrogant. They were saying things in this bold way, but they were also doing it in an arrogant way. And they basically saying they were speaking with an extreme amount of confidence. And unfortunately, human beings have a tendency to go along with people when they speak of something very confidently. This is something that we just have a tendency to do, even if it's something that is absolutely wrong. And so these false teachers were speaking with this bold confidence about what they believed. But what they were doing is they were heaping abuse on celestial beings. Well, that sounds confusing. What does that mean? What he means by celestial beings is he probably is referring to demons, fallen angels who were created by God and still hold some evidence of God's magnificent creative power upon them. But yet they fell and went with Satan instead of staying with God. And so they are now fallen. And by him saying they're not afraid, they mean they don't tremble at these dark spiritual powers. They almost think they're superior to them. They cast judgment upon them. And what's dangerous about doing that is what he says in the next verse, in verse 11, that angels, even though they're stronger and more powerful than demons and stronger and more powerful than humans, don't do that kind of thing. They don't heap abuse. They don't put judgment upon even demons, because what they're doing is what he actually says here is that they are allowing God to take care of that part of the equation. They're letting God be the one who judges them. They don't want to take that place. They don't want to take the place of God. And that's what the false teachers were doing by viewing themselves as more, probably maybe more powerful than demons, or even just doubting their actual existence, that there is any evil whatsoever. But instead, what these people do is these false teachers, they blaspheme in matters they don't understand. What he means by saying that blasphemy is this slandering of God or of religious things. And by the fact that they were, what we learned last week, teaching destructive heresies, things that were totally against what Jesus taught and what the apostles taught, and it was destroying people's spiritual lives, that what's going on here is Peter is saying this is actually blasphemy. This is slandering God, because it so changes the gospel, so changes it that it changes the nature and person of God, which is not what you want to do. And that's the thing that is ultimately blasphemy. But it's in matters that these false teachers don't understand. And the reason Peter says that is he's saying they don't know the actual truth, because I was there. I saw Jesus. Peter saw Jesus transfigured before himself and two other apostles, and that they saw him as he would be when he would return someday. In Matthew 17, we call the transfiguration. And so Peter is the one who understands this, because he was given the faith by Jesus. He didn't come up with this himself like he's saying the false teachers did. And so they're blaspheming in matters they don't understand. They don't really know the truth. And that he makes this very interesting analogy here, that they are like unreasoning animals, creatures of instinct. Basically, that they acted in a way that just acted upon their own desires, feelings, and instincts rather than upon good reason. And this is actually why it's really important for us as Christians to have well-reasoned belief, logic out beliefs, that we understand what it is that we believe, instead of being subject to our emotions. Because if we leave ourselves simply just subject to our emotions and our feelings and just going with whatever we feel, I promise you, we will tend to go towards sin, because that's a result of the sin nature that we have. And so he's calling them, they're simply like animals that just act upon instinct. That's all they're doing. They're going on their gut, what they want to do. And that he says they are born only to be caught and destroyed. And what he is saying by that is actually kind of, in a way, it's this vivid picture of God being the hunter and they're the prey. That's a terrifying place to be. I don't know if you can picture that being the prey of God, who is coming after them, and that they are going to perish, because God is seeing what they are doing and they are destroying his truth, destroying the gospel, and deceiving people away from him so that he couldn't save them. And now he wants to deal with evil. This is a huge part of God being God, is dealing with evil. And so, because of their overall attitude, these false teachers, about believing they're more superior than demons, or they are more powerful, or they doubt their existence, or they're speaking in bold confidence and arrogance, thinking that they are better in some ways than God, this is what our first characteristic is that false teachers seek to take the place of God. James quotes Proverbs 3:34 in his book in the New Testament, where he says, God is opposed to the proud, but gives grace to the humble. It should be a very fearful place for us to be in a position where God is actively opposed to us. Because pride at its very core is an elevation of oneself above God, saying that we are better, that we know better. It's like saying, I know better of what I need and what I want in this life. I don't need God. I can figure this out for myself. I know what I'm doing. I know what I want and need. And it goes back to actually Adam and Eve. Pride is the very root sin of all of us, that we would say we know better. It's like that we, like Adam and Eve did, Satan tempted them with becoming like God, knowing good and evil, and that's what we're doing. We're taking the place of God that he never gave us the ability, didn't give us the ability to have. And so that's what these false teachers are doing. They are elevating themselves above God. And so consider this more of a warning, okay? That not just to critique false teachers and call them out, but also to look into ourselves and say, I don't want to come to a place where I'm elevating myself above God in anything that I am doing, because as it says, God is opposed to the proud, but gives grace to the humble. And the humble attitude is what James says next. He says, submit yourselves therefore to God, that we would submit to him and say, your will be done. Your truth is the real truth. Your word is what I base my life upon. And that is a posture of genuine Christian faith. And so that when we also are now looking at and critiquing and understanding, trying to understand false teachers, that we would say, if they have something that they teach that does not come from God's word, and they say, this is a revelation I got from God, but it doesn't match up with God's word, then we can easily say, no, thank you. That is not the truth, because it does not come from God. So keep that as a warning. Let's continue. Verse 13. They will be paid back with harm for the harm they have done. Their idea of pleasure is to carouse in broad daylight. They are blots and blemishes, reveling in their pleasures while they feast with you. With eyes full of adultery, they never stop sinning. They seduce the unstable. They are experts in greed, an accursed brood. They have left the straight way and wandered off to follow the way of Balaam, son of Beor, who loved the wages of wickedness, but he was rebuked for his wrongdoing by a donkey, an animal without speech, who spoke with a human voice and restrained the prophet's madness. In that first sentence, Peter is basically saying that these false teachers are going to reap what they have sown. Because they have deceived and distorted the gospel and pulled people away from Christ, that now, and that has brought harm onto those people, now God is going to bring harm upon these false teachers. Destruction is coming. But then he kind of gives some ways that how they have acted. First of all, they have pursued their pleasures in broad daylight. Most people, when they sin, try and do it in hiding, try and keep it a secret, keep it away from people. But these people were doing it in the middle of the day where everybody could see it, because they had no shame. They felt they were totally free to do whatever they wanted, and so they did. And this is what they are, and he says that because of this, they are blots and blemishes. This is in contrast to us, for those of us who are true followers of Christ. When we put our faith in Christ, Jesus says about us, and Paul, and the apostles affirm this, that we are spotless and blameless before him, that there are no blots and blemishes on our record whatsoever because of Christ's finished work on the cross and him washing us completely clean. But because they claimed to be Christians and acted upon these sinful desires, they were actual blemishes to the church's reputation. We talked about this last week, that they would, that people would look on them, look at them and say, wow, if that's what it means to be a Christian, that you can just go and do whatever you want, what's the point of even becoming a Christian? What's the point? And so it damages the church's reputation. But they were doing this while they were going to what's called these love feasts. So they were reveling in their, what actually the word here is deceitfulness, while they feast with you. They did the early church did this practice, and I think it's a really cool practice. They called it love feasts. Now, in our culture, that could sound really strange and kind of creepy when you put it that way, but what the love feasts were these times where the church would gather together as a family and have a meal together, spend time with one another, and all of it would culminate in taking the Lord's Supper, as we're going to do later. And it's a celebration and a remembrance of who Jesus is and what he has done. And that is that you're basically acting out in love towards one another, showing each other that others' deeds or others' and needs are more important than your own, and that you're seeking others' good more than yourself. And that this was in contrast to the false teachers, because what they were doing is they were reveling in the fact that they were pursuing their own pleasures. And so this was, they were being deceitful in pursuing their pleasures instead of looking out for the good of others. So they are reveling in it. But then he says this very interesting phrase that with eyes full of adultery, they never stop sinning. He actually, it's kind of says the same thing twice. It's a parallel, and that the second phrase kind of extends it. When he says eyes full of adultery, he actually means with eyes full of an adulteress. Essentially, he's saying that they look at every single woman as a potential candidate to commit adultery with. So they're always looking around, always looking for a woman to commit adultery with. And then he says that they're actually, their eyes are full of sin. That they're just looking for opportunities to sin. They're constantly pursuing it. And that what they do is they seduce the unstable. And Peter has actually, in this passage, has a lot of hunting and fishing kind of analogies. And so when he uses the word seduce, he's actually using a bait on a hook. That they're throwing it out there, that they are seducing people. And we'll talk more about what they were using in a little bit, but they were their targets were the unstable, the spiritually immature, who didn't know better, who weren't ready and weren't prepared, who weren't grounded in their faith, and that these false teachers are experts in greed, meaning they're well trained in greed. It's the word there is actually where we get our word gymnasium. Okay, so they were well trained, they knew what they were doing, and they acted in greed, and they were accursed children because of the fact that they were distorting and changing the gospel. And so then they have left this straight way, and this refers to something Jesus said in the Gospels where he talks about the small and narrow way, the small gate and narrow way that few find, but it leads to life. But then on the other side, there is a wide gate and broad road that is easy, but it leads to destruction. And that actually the early church called themselves the way. They didn't call themselves Christians. That came much later, and that was a term that was put on them by people who were not within the church. So they originally called themselves the way. And what's happening here is he is pointing to these two different ways. So you have the way of Jesus, and you have the way of the world. And he goes to this interesting story from the Old Testament. So if you're not familiar with this character, Balaam, son of Beor, go home today. If you're not familiar with the Bible, go home and read Numbers 22 through 24. But let me give you as brief a summary as I possibly can, because there's a lot going on in this story. Basically, Balaam is this pagan prophet, and he is out for the money and for the pleasure of it. He is a greedy guy. He's all about himself. He gets called by the king of Moab, who wants him to come and curse the nation of Israel, who was about to enter into the promised land. The king of Moab wants to curse him because he's afraid that they're going to conquer him. But God had actually told Moses, don't attack Moab because they are your brothers. Stay away from them. Don't do anything. So he's attacking them uselessly, but the king of Moab doesn't know this. He doesn't know that the curse doesn't really matter. And so what happens is Balaam then decides to go and take up this king's offer. But on the way, while he is going, God knows his motives aren't clear. Even though he says, oh, I'll only speak what God tells me to speak, it's really more for himself. He wants the money. He wants the payment. And so while they're walking, all of a sudden, you see this in verse 16, he was rebuked for his wrongdoing by a donkey. That should really throw us off for a second, that a donkey would do some rebuking. Because here's what happened. They're on the path, and the donkey stops in the middle of the road because the donkey sees the angel of the Lord. And the angel of the Lord is holding a sword, and he's ready to strike Balaam for the wickedness of what he was going to do. And so Balaam gets mad. He's upset at his donkey. He strikes her three times and trying to get her to move, trying to get her to go. And with the irony of the statement here is actually that the donkey, the unreasoning animal at this moment, has more spiritual insight than the supposed prophet at this moment. And she sees it, and eventually God opens up his eyes by having the donkey speak. Yes, God has a donkey speak in the Bible. It is quite an interesting moment that happens in the story. But the donkey rebukes him and restrains the prophet's madness, keeps him from going forward. But it's really interesting that Peter calls him a son of Beor, because if you look back at the story, his name is actually Balaam, son of Beor. And why he does this is Beezer actually is probably close to saying son of the flesh, that it was all about his desires, his passion. And Peter likes play on words throughout this entire story, and that we see Balaam's true heart is that he loved the wages of wickedness. Peter is making a comparison between him and the false teachers, that they were just like Balaam. And what Balaam did in response to this event is he actually later on orchestrates a plan with the king of Moab to bring in women from Moab to get married to and seduce Israelite men in order for them to then commit idolatry and worship their gods, and in order to try and destroy the nation of Israel. But God takes care of it. He puts judgment upon Balaam and upon all the people who got into that situation, and then clears it up. And so Balaam eventually is executed for what he did by orchestrating these events. And that is what the fall is coming for these false teachers. So this is our second characteristic of a false teacher, because you see what Balaam did by going after weak-willed men, and the false teacher seducing the unstable. This is what they do. False teachers deceive and manipulate the spiritually immature. Unfortunately, the most vulnerable time for a Christian is right after the time when they first give their lives to Christ. And this is why it is absolutely essential for us to work with people who have just given their lives to Christ, to disciple them so that, as Paul says, they can become rooted and grounded and built up in their faith, so that they won't be as susceptible to the lies and deceit of false teachers. Because you're truly going to have a very hard time finding mature and wise and stable followers of Christ fall for the lies of false teachers. They will be able to see right through them. But a false teacher uses a lot of different means in order to deceive people. And maybe in their minds, they're thinking that I've got this figured out. I know what God has said. This is what God wants me to do. So they might have every good motive in their own mind, but because it is a departure from the truth of what the gospel is and what the Bible says, then it is a method that is being used by Satan to deceive people. So they'll take advantage of people's desire for, and even good desire of, trying to take care of themselves financially. They'll take advantage of that, people's fear of not being able to pay the bills. They'll take advantage of people's desires of wanting to pursue certain things. And so they'll justify certain sins that the Bible says absolutely clearly that this is not right. We'll talk about that in a minute. But at the heart of all of this, what they are doing, they are simply twisting, deceiving, and manipulating. And we have got to watch out for it and be protected and rooted and grounded in our faith so that we will not be deceived. Let's continue. Verse 17. These people are springs without water and mists driven by a storm. Blackest darkness is reserved for them, for they mouth empty, boastful words, and by appealing to the lustful desires of the flesh, they entice people who are just escaping from those who live in error. They promise them freedom while they themselves are slaves of depravity, for people are slaves to whatever has mastered them. So when he says these people, that he means the false teacher. And what he's talking about, you come to a spring, you might be really thirsty, you might be parched, but then you approach it and you examine it for what it really is. They're teaching for what it really is, that there's no substance, there's no sustenance that can be provided to that, no sustaining force in a believer's life. And that what they teach, it's tantalizing. It may look like it's true, but it's really mist. You can't actually grasp at it. And that at any moment, a wind could just drive it away, just get rid of it, to remove it. So there's no sustaining force. And so as a result of this, he says, blackest darkness is reserved for them. This is his anger really starting to come out. And we're really seeing that he's pushing this theme over and over again, that judgment is coming. Judgment is coming for them. Don't forget that God will act on our behalf to deal with the evil that has been in the world. And what they do is, now he's going to start kind of getting into some of their other methods, that they mouth empty but boastful words. So empty meaning that there's no substance to it whatsoever. There's nothing really there to it. It might sound really nice. It might sound really friendly, but it's not. There's no depth to it. There's not any truth to it. But that, and again, it's boastful. It's confident. It's arrogant. So they look like they know what they're talking about. And that their principal method as they appeal to the lustful desires of the flesh. As we talked about that last week, sexual sins, the desires of the flesh, or whatever people want to pursue, anything along those lines, he says that this is what they use to entice people who are just escaping their previous life in error. What he's talking about here is, again, that word entice, it's like a bait on a hook. And the bait is actually living a lustful desire of the flesh. You can pursue any greed that you want. You can pursue any sexual pleasures that you desire and that you want. You have that freedom in Christ to do that, is what these false teachers were teaching. And so by appealing to this, this is their bait and hook, that they're pulling people in. But what it's going to do is not actually what it promises, because what they are promising is freedom. But what actually happens is they are actually, they themselves, slaves of depravity, because look at this, for people are slaves to whatever has mastered them. Because of the fact that they had eyes full of an adulteress and eyes full of sin, and they actively pursued it, that they were actually slaves because they then had to go for it. They had to pursue it because their eyes were full of it. They deeply wanted it. They wanted whatever they wanted, and they did this for people, proclaiming that there would be freedom. And again, it's for those who just, he said, escape those who live in error. They just came out of their old life and came to follow Christ. And so Tom Schreiner, who is the commentator I've consulted the most for this series, he says, the false teachers were as misleading and seductive as the hunter who attempts to catch his prey. They were promising freedom to do whatever you wanted, but it was an illusion, an absolute illusion, and would lead to further enslavement to sin because they were mastered by it and they had to pursue it. And we know this, it's now well documented in our days and in psychological circles, that sexual addiction and pornography addiction are real things, that people go for it and they have eyes full of it, that their hearts desire it, so they go for it and they can't get out of it. They are mastered by it. So we know that this is a very serious and real thing that is happening to them. And I want to make sure I clear something else up as well. It makes it seem like that Peter is saying that people can believe in Christ and then walk away. I don't believe that. I think what he's doing here is he's actually giving language that makes, like, all by all appearances, they looked like they were followers of Christ, but because of being deceived and being pulled out, it shows, as John said, that they really were not from us. That's basically what John says in the book of 1 John. And so Peter is using this language just simply from our perspective. It looked like they walked away from their old life, but really now they're back in it because of the appeal of what the false teachers were talking about. But what the false teachers were teaching, by the fact that you could go after whatever lustful desires you want and you have the freedom to do so, this leads us to our third characteristic, that false teachers legitimize sinfulness. The reality is when we come to Jesus, we are called to die to our sin and the old ways that we lived. And not just that, but that Jesus called us out of our darkness and pulled us into the light of his Son, into his kingdom. And that what we learned from earlier in this book is that Jesus has given us everything we need to defeat sin in our lives. That now we are no longer slaves to sin and mastered by sin, but now that we are slaves of righteousness, that we are mastered by righteousness and by Jesus himself, because the Holy Spirit is living in us, we now have everything we need to follow Christ. It's not a freedom to pursue anything we want, but it is a freedom from whatever has held us back. Christ never once legitimizes sinfulness. Sometimes false teachers will legitimize things like greed. They'll legitimize adultery. They'll legitimize other sins that are listed in the Bible. They might even tell you that you can tell God to do what you want him to do, that you can call it out in faith and he will do it because you are in that position to do so. But we should never go and get into that place. But we also should never justify sin in a way where we say, you know what, this is just where I am in my journey. This is where I'm at. This is just who I am. I can't really help it. I'm just this way. Because just make sure you hear me on this. Christ definitely takes us as we are, but he loves us enough to not leave us there. He doesn't want us to stay in those things, in that old life. So we should always be looking for opportunities and be relentless to grow so that we can move our way out of those things, even if it means some temporary uncomfortability in this life. Let's continue, verse 20. If they have escaped the corruption of the world by knowing our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and are again entangled in it and are overcome, they are worse off at the end than they were at the beginning. It would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness and then to have known it and then to turn their backs on the sacred command that was passed on to them. Of them, the Proverbs are true. A dog returns to its vomit, and a sow that is washed returns to her wallowing in the mud. And so what Peter is doing here, it's actually the language is kind of vague. We're not sure if he's talking about the false teachers specifically here or people who have been deceived by false teachers. But because of the vagueness of it, it should be a warning to all of us to watch out for this, to keep our eyes on the lookout for what he's talking about here. That we could escape quite literally, the defilements of the world, the sin that has entangled us, the sin that has held us back, that has defiled and marred the image of God that has been placed upon us when God created us. And that we escape this by coming to a knowledge of Jesus, that he is Lord and Savior, that he has come to die on the cross for our sins, and that what ends up happening is we then are entangled back in our old ways of life, and we are overcome, we are mastered by them, and that we have, because we're submitting, the people were submitting to the false teachers' lies, now they are just back at where they began, and he says they are worse off than they were. They are worse off at the end now than they were at the beginning. The ESV translates it this way. The last state has become worse for them than the first. And when he's talking about the beginning, what he means is at that time when they initially gave their lives to Christ. Whatever situation they were in at that moment, that's the beginning. But now they're worse off at this point by falling back into what they used to be in, because their return from it is extremely unlikely. Because they'll start to think of it as a phase, as an emotional moment where they just got caught up in the situation and said that they were going to follow Christ. And so it makes it very difficult for people to return from this point. And many of us have seen it happen, and I've seen it happen in my life. And he even says this is somewhat surprising, that it would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness. It would have been better for them not to have come to a knowledge that Jesus is Lord and Savior, that Jesus has a radical, new, transformed life that he is offering up for you if you give your life for him. That's what he means by the way of righteousness. And he says it's better that they just didn't know it and instead turning their backs on it, on this sacred command to live this holy life. It just would have been better if they never heard about it whatsoever. Because again, their return is extremely unlikely. Because maybe someday down the road, if they had never turned, they could have turned for the first time later, realizing their real need for Christ. But then he gets to verse 22. And when he says this, he's doing a parallel of two proverbs. The first one comes from about a dog returns to its vomit. It's from Proverbs 26:11. It says, as a dog returns to its vomit, so a fool repeats his folly. And what he's talking about here between these two is that, first of all, dogs and pigs were considered unclean animals by the Israelites. Because dogs back in that day, they weren't household pets. What they were they were wild, they were on the streets on their own, and that they had a tendency to return to sniff their own vomit. And if you've had a dog, you've seen your dog probably do some disgusting things throughout your life, okay? Throughout your time, you've had them. Dogs can be kind of disgusting, but what he's saying is that it's people who return to what was disgusting, their old sin of life, and so that they appeared to once know Christ, but now have returned to their old way of life. And the pig proverb says much of the same thing, that a pig was washed clean, and so it's like people who are washed clean by Christ, but now they return to going back and just being in their filth and the old life, the mud and the muck and the mire. And so what's happening here is by the false teachers doing all of this, by pulling people away, appealing to their desires and having them be deceived, what they are doing is this, and our fourth characteristic, that false teachers reject or distort the gospel of Jesus Christ. False teachers in our day might say things like, you can continue to live the way that you want or the way that you used to before you came to Christ. You are forgiven already, so go and do what you want. Or they'll justify things and say that these are okay, even though the Bible says these are expressly viewed as sin. or that God will give you anything you want simply if you just have enough faith and you ask him in faith. They might even say you just need to add works to your life so that you can experience the fullness of what salvation really is, or that God is this vengeful, angry, wrathful, judgmental God who is simply coming to destroy you unless you repent. Or that God is just this big God of love, this fluffy teddy bear that wants to just give you a hug and needs you in his life. Or even just say that Jesus was not God, but he's just simply this wise moral teacher and whose death was just a great example of self-giving love for other people. And all of this to say is that the gospel should never, ever be distorted or changed. Because it is the foundational truth of our faith that Christ, out of his great love for us, died in our deserved place because of our sin, took on all of our sin upon himself on the cross, and paid the full price of our sins at his death. And that 3 days later, when he rose again, he satisfied God's wrath against our sin, and that by putting our faith in him and in him alone to save us, that we are declared righteous by him, and that we are brought into a radically new and transformed life through his Spirit dwelling in us, and that someday Christ will return and that he will finish his work by completely transforming everything about us so that all of our old selves are completely gone and done with forever. That is the gospel. And if we distort or reject or deceive anybody or change it at all, it's rejecting Jesus. And we don't want to get to that place, because that is a beautiful and incredible and amazing story of what God has done for us and what he wants to continue to do in our lives. So Jesus' ultimate conclusion in the Sermon on the Mount, after he talks about the fact that there's going to be false teachers among you, he says that not everyone who says, "Lord, Lord," will be saved. Some, they'll come and they'll say, "We performed miracles. We prophesied in your name," that these are symbols of false teachers who are saying, "We did all these things for you." And Jesus says, "You didn't know me. You didn't know me." The point is that we need to know him. But then he also says later at the end that to really know him is to build your life upon him and on him alone. And so that this is the ultimate thing that will keep us from falling into the trap of false teachers, that we stand firm on Christ and Christ alone. We look to him as our ultimate source of truth, and that the teachers we listen to ought to look and resemble Christ in the way that they live. And if they don't, and if they teach some of these things, then we can start to teach some of the things that distract people and some of these false ways, then we can say we're going to move on from them, because we don't want to be distracted. We want to teach the real thing. But then we ask the question, what about those who have walked away? I said it was difficult, but I didn't say it was impossible. With God, all things are possible. Okay? God can do the work. So what we need to do is to keep on praying for those people that we know in our lives, that God can break down their hearts, even if they seem like they are so hardened that they want nothing to do with God. And so let's remember the whole thing of what we've talked about this morning, that false teachers seek to take the place of God. They deceive and manipulate the spiritually immature, legitimize sinfulness, and reject or distort the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let's pray. God, we thank you so much for this morning. We love you. We thank you that you have given us this gospel, this truth, this way that we can be saved and come to a knowledge of you. So Jesus, may we take it up. God, take it as it is revealed in your word. And God, that we would be only influenced in teachers by those who would say that this is the truth. And God, that we would be able to start to have discernment, to be able to recognize those who are and who are not false teachers. And God, to be able to help others in that way as well. God, not in a way of anger or judgment, but simply recognizing, God, that you desire for people to come to a relationship with you. And Jesus, that you don't want things to distract or distort that. And so Jesus, we thank you for this time. We pray this in your name. Amen.